Right. So this is a picture of a dual chamber pacemaker, the right atrial lead, the right ventricular lead. Now, you should, I want to tell you also that at least for last 15 years or so, I don't put the right ventricular lead in the apex, where most of the people put in the apex. Why? Because God has devised a system where the electricity travels from sinus node to the AV node, from AV node, his Purkinje system down. So it's from above down. If you put the lead in the RV apex, it is the other way around. It will come from the apex to the base. Now, what has been seen that some of the patients, something like 6 to 8% of the people, if you give them the right ventricular apical pacing, they develop a cardiomyopathy. Their heart dilates, the ejection fraction comes down. Like at the time of pacing, the LV was normal, but after 2 years, 3 years, they will come with heart failure. This is called as right ventricular apical pacing induced cardiomyopathy. But if you want to prevent that, then best is to do his bundle pacing. You do a his bundle pacing. Now the problem with the his bundle pacing is that it's a little bit difficult and it's a little time consuming, and most of the people, they are not capable of doing his bundle pacing. If you do his bundle pacing, you mimic God, same thing as God has done. But if you can't do his bundle pacing, at least do a mid septal pacing or para-Hessian pacing. If you do mid septal pacing, again, most of the electric depolarization will from above to down, and that will prevent the cardiomyopathy. So I have never seen pacing-induced cardiomyopathy in my patients particularly who have been given the mid-septal or paraseptal pacing. But I have seen these patients coming from other operators, and if you develop pacing-induced cardiomyopathy, then there are two options. Either you give them, do the his bundle pacing, or you have to convert them into triple chamber pacemaker or CRT, and they do very well actually. They do improve a lot after that. Okay, so what is this ECG? Again, somebody? Pardon? Complete heart block. Okay, as I told you, you should look at the ECG, P wave, QRS complex, and relation. See, if you see, pardon? No, okay, but you first have said complete heart block. This is P wave. Okay. P wave, KRS complex, P wave, KRS complex, P wave, KRS complex. So P waves are correlated. See, there is a correlation between P wave and KRS complex. I don't. Well, right, it may be there is a little tall T wave, but the tall T waves are not so tall in this patient. Like I have taken, they are very tall waves, and so basically it is 1:1 conduction, but PR is grossly prolonged. That's what I can see personally. And the another thing is, why it is not hyperkalemia? I tell you why. If you have hyperkalemia, usually QRS will be prolonged. It is not narrow like that. You will develop intraventricular conduction defect. Here QRS is narrow. So it is unlikely to be hyperkalemia, but this is a first degree AV block. And now you should remember one thing more, that in this patient, if you see very carefully, there is a P here, for example, and there is a second perhaps P wave, which is over the T wave. So in such patient, you need to look very carefully. The P and QRS, the T wave may sometimes mix. So it may be two, because it's a bradycardia. So it may be 2:1 block, but it is not very definite from the CCG. But certainly, most likely, it is 2:1 block, and this patient needs a pacemaker. Okay. So what is this ECG? Anybody? This patient again, 67 years female. They came with the history, the seizures. Pardon? See, there are four possibilities: sinus bradycardia, complete heart block, 2:1 block, sinus tachycardia. So what is the diagnosis? So you said 2:1 block. Anybody else? Complete heart block. Who said that? Yes. Why? Right. He's right. See, if you see, when you want to describe the rhythm, you concentrate on the rhythm strip. For example, there's a long recording of lead 2. P wave here, then there is a P wave here, then there is a P wave here, then there is a P wave here, then P wave here, P wave here. There is a P wave, just QRS complex, it's mixed almost. And if you see the last one, P wave is over the QRS complex. So that means there is no relation between P wave and the QRS complex. This is a complete heart block, and this patient obviously needs a pacemaker, and this is what the diagnosis is. And of course the same thing, we will need a pacemaker in this patient. What is this? 50 years female, complains of lethargy. Yes, please. Sinus bradycardia, junctional rhythm, sinus exit block, complete heart block. Can anybody tell me what is the difference between sinus arrest and sinus exit block? Any physician? The smart gentleman doing like this, please. What's your name? Hani? Aap batao bhaiya. Hani? Anybody who knows? Okay. Sinus arrest means, there is no sinus node ki depolarization hui nahi. So there is no generation of electric current from the sinus node. Sinus exit block means that there is a depolarization of the sinus cells. They have produced the electric current, but it has not gone into the atrium. So if you see, the diagnosis is that sinus rest will be that you will have a pause, you will have multiple pauses, but the QRS complexes, there will be no relationship. For example, if you have RR intervals, some fixed relationship, that is the time when you suspect exit block. For example, if there are two depolarization in the sinus node, out of those two, only one went into the atria. So you will have, in that patient will look like only bradycardia, like this patient. This patient could be 2:1 sinus exit block, but it could also be just sinus bradycardia. It's not possible to differentiate between these two conditions. It is possible to differentiate between sinus arrest and sinus exit block. So though the treatment is anyway a pacemaker, but intellectually you should understand how the things are happening in a particular patient. In this patient, I don't see there is a correlation between P waves and QRS complex. There is a slow heart rate, so it sounds like more like a sinus bradycardia to me, until and unless somebody has a difference of opinion. So this is sinus bradycardia, and here this patient complains lethargy. Now you have to be very careful. People may complain lethargy when they have normal heart, normal rhythm, but if this lady complains exertional lethargy, if she says कि जी काम करने में मैं लेथार्जी हूँ, मैं काम नहीं कर सकती, फिर मेरे को थकावट हो जाती है, बैठे-बैठे she feels okay, then in this patient you can do a treadmill test, for example, and if you do a treadmill test, if you demonstrate that there is a chronotropic inadequate response, that the heart rate doesn't increase with exercise, this patient will be benefited by rate response atrial pacemaker. Okay. Right, yeah, you are right. Yeah, this could be very right. When you have bradycardia, you should rule out, you should rule up bradycardia, you should rule out some drugs. This patient may be on beta blocker. You must rule out the etiologies which can cause, it's very common actually. These days, one of the commonest causes is beta blockers. Many patients are on beta blocker, they can have a slow heart rate. Okay, I want to understand from any physician, what do you mean by exactly syncope? What is the definition of syncope? What is syncope? We are going to more basic things. What is syncope? Aap batao, Dr. Sahab. The smart female, bataiye. No, I'm not satisfied. Anybody? Yes. Pardon? Sudden? Unconscious. And there is sudden unconsciousness because of lack of. Cerebrum, yes, he's right. See, syncope is, it is a transient loss of consciousness due to global hypoperfusion of the brain. Okay? It is different than a seizure. Seizure is very different, by the way. Seizure is very different than syncope. Now, some of the patients, okay, tell me, Dr. Sahab, this gentleman, if a patient has syncope, the patient should be referred to which specialty? According to you? No, no. Let him tell. You have a patient who has a syncope, he should be referred to which doctor? What about you, lady? If a patient has syncope? Neurologist. Okay. Now listen carefully. Syncope is a purely cardiovascular phenomenon. It has nothing to do with neurology. No neurologist has done any good to a patient of syncope. In India, practically all the patients who have syncope, practically, they go to neurologist. Either themselves or even they are referred to neurologist. They'll do CT scan, they'll do MRI, they'll do EEG, 40,000 down the drain and no benefit to the patient. Why? Because we have not analyzed, if it's a syncope, it's a seizure, you can send the patient to the neurologist. But if it's a syncope, it's a purely, syncope occurs because of three reasons, by the way. Syncope occurs, three or four, I would say, mainly three reasons. When there is sudden bradycardia. Number two, when there is a sudden tachycardia. For example, somebody with ventricular tachycardia, rate 220. Particularly if the heart is damaged already, they develop hypotension, they have a syncope. And thirdly, loss of vasomotor tone, which is very common in general public, so-called vasovagal syncope. And there's another fourth important cause is postural hypotension. Now postural hypotension is common in elderly people, particularly who have diabetes, where the autonomic nervous system is a little bit defective. Or patient is on drugs, particularly antihypertensive. It's very common people have syncope. So these are the mainly four reasons of syncope. And syncope should be differentiated from neurological phenomena like seizure, like a stroke. For example, I know cardiologists even, patient of syncope, they'll do carotid Doppler. There is 80% stenosis and they will put a carotid stent. Okay, that's a different, you can put a stent, but that is not a patient's problem. Patient problem is syncope. So there's a difference between syncope and neurological phenomena. The only true neurological cause of syncope is there is something called akinetic seizure. Akinetic seizure means patient falls down, there's no jerks, But it's a very, very rare phenomena. I don't think, even, I don't know whether there is any neurologist here. It's a very rare phenomenon. So by and large, you say it's a neurological, it's a cardiovascular phenomenon. Okay. Now this is a 50 years old male. He had two episodes of syncope. In fact, this patient was in the CCU when the CCU was recorded. Okay, and his echo was normal, and his basal ECG also didn't show much. He's 58. What is the diagnosis? Monomorphic. But if you see, my dear, all the leads, the complexes, the shape goes on changing. They are not same shape. It is not monomorphic. It is a typical story of a polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. It's a VT which is polymorphic. And if I give you the hint that let's say echo was normal, what is the likely possibility? He has two episodes of syncope. He is not on drugs of any kind. No history of diarrhea. I mean to say, no, nothing to suggest hypokalemia or hypocalcemia. Well, it's a TDP, of course. It's a dorsal deep pointers. See, when you have this kind of ECG, you should think about ischemia. But history-wise, it's unlikely because there are two episodes that difference pehle bhi ho chuka hai. Then you should think about QT prolongation syndromes. So when the patient is cardioverted, see the ECG or see the previous ECGs or the history of anything to suggest hypokalemia or hypocalcemia, or if a patient is taking some drugs like phenothiazines, like antiarrhythmic drugs. But if there's everything is negative, think about Brugada syndrome. There is a something called Brugada syndrome. They have, in fact, if you see their ECGs, I don't know whether I have that ECG, must be there in the file. They have little ST elevation in V1, V2, V3. Sometimes the ECG, when they come to you, will be normal. But if you suspect strongly, then you can give them a challenge of flickanite. You keep them in the emergency, take the ECG, give 300 milligram of flickanite, do the ECG after 1 hour, and after 2 hours, you can demonstrate if there is an underlying Brugada, sometimes those changes will emerge out, so-called flickanite challenge. All right. So this is TDP, and I have discussed the reasons for that. Of course, acute treatment is cardioversion. You have to be right away. All right. This is a 55 years old male, and he had a bypass surgery done in 2012. Ejection fraction 30%, and he has pre-syncope. Anybody? Who said that? Somebody said. You said? Yeah. Monomorphic ventricular tachycardia. It's very right. It's a good diagnosis. It is a regular tachycardia. It's a broad complex. And there is a story of post coronary artery disease, post myocardial infarction. If you have history of MI in any patient in the past, and he comes with a broad complex tachycardia, without seeing the ECG or the patient, you can say it's a VT, because 95% chances are that that patient has ventricular tachycardia. Just the history of MI and a broad complex tachycardia, the sensitivity of reliability of this history is almost 95%. So this is a monomorphic ventricular tachycardia, ejection fraction 30%. So how will you manage this patient? क्या करोगे क्या? The gentleman next to you, yes, please. आप क्या करोगे? ये patient आपके पास आता है, क्या करोगे? Very right. See, he is absolutely right. This is ischemic BT, scar based BT. You cardiovert this guy, and it's a class 1 indication of ICD. Nothing else you should think about this patient. Now, patients who have ischemic VT with a decreased ejection fraction, ablation is not the first choice. They don't do well with ablation, because even if you do, if there is one ventricular tachycardia, single morphology, even if you ablate, the chance of sudden cardiac death remain high, because they can have another VT. So you have to give them ICD, but if they have on ICD, if they have repeated ventricular tachycardia where a patient gets repeated shock, then you can do ablation for these patients, and which is very effective in fact. Okay, what is this? This is a, I think, let's say 48 years man who has some diabetes and he comes with chest pain. What are the diagnosis? Anterior myocardial infarction. I think this is very clear. There is a gross ST segment elevation and anterior myocardial infarction. So this is the patient who needs either primary PCI or he needs a thrombolysis right away. Okay. See, you can also not only diagnose acute myocardial infarction, you can also diagnose the place where it got blocked, whether it is proximal, whether it's mid segment, whether it is before the septal, after the septal. So that's what I said in the beginning, that if you really developed interest in the ECG, you can tell the cardiologist that, Mr. So-and-so, I am sending a patient who is 48 years man and anterior bowel infarction. I think he's got LED blocked before the first septal. Maza aaya na? That before doing the angiography, aapne us bande ko ye bhi bata diya ki LED block kahan hai. And these criteria are available in the this thing. So this is a proximal LED stenosis. Okay. Now this is a simpler. This is a 35 years old lady who complains of repetitive palpitations. This is the first time that ECG was done when she had palpitation. What is the diagnosis here? Pardon? Which tachycardia? Sinus tachycardia. My dear, why sinus tachycardia? Can you see P waves here? P wave to hai nahi, sinus tachycardia kyun keh rahe ho? See, again I told you, go to the basic. You see the rhythm. It's a narrow complex, first of all. It's a narrow complex. Heart rate is more than 100. That means a tachycardia. It's a narrow complex tachycardia. It's a regular tachycardia. It's a regular tachycardia. Now, I can't see P waves anywhere in the ECG. So if you have narrow complex tachycardia, AVNRT, very right. What is the differential diagnosis here? What is the DD, differential diagnosis? It is a narrow complex tachycardia. See, listen now, carefully. It's very simple, it's not a rocket science again, I tell you. Arrhythmias are either supraventricular, that means above the junction of the heart, or they are ventricular, or they are junctional tachycardia. Now, atrial tachycardia means the origin of abnormal rhythm is in the atrial tissue. And this arrhythmia does not need the junction of the heart or the ventricle to sustain. For example, if there is a patient who has a complete heart block and he can have atrial tachycardia, because atrial tachycardia doesn't need ventricle. If there is a ventricular arrhythmia, they don't need atria, they don't need junction of the heart to sustain. Ventricle se shuru hota hai, ventricular tachycardia. It is arising somewhere from the ventricular tissue, right, left, or the septum, or even his Purkinje system. Then there are junctional tachycardias. They need junction of the heart. They need the participation of the junction and atrium and the ventricle. Like, for example, AVNRT. AVNRT, the circuit is in the AV node itself. There are two pathways, slow pathway and fast pathway. So re-entry occurs in the AV node itself. The differential diagnosis of this patient is AVRT. AVRT means atrioventricular reentrant tachycardia. AVRT are based on accessory pathways. So if you have, let's say, left side pathway or a right side pathway, the circuit here is his Purkinje system, normal AV node, it goes to the ventricle, it goes back through the accessory pathway like this. If the conduction is down, anti-grade conduction is over the normal his Purkinje system and retrograde is over the accessory pathway, it will be narrow complex, simple, because the activation of the ventricles are occurring not in normal his Purkinje system. So it will be a regular narrow complex tachycardia. But if the re-entry is the other way around, that the anti-grade conduction is over the accessory pathway directly into the ventricle and back going over the AV node, then it will be broad complex tachycardia. If you have a broad complex tachycardia, it is called as antidromic tachycardia. If it is normal narrow complex, it is called orthodromic tachycardia. Ortho means straight, straight in the sense that it's going straight over the AV node. So accessory pathways, they produce three rhythm disorders. One, they produce orthodromic narrow complex tachycardia, or they produce antidromic broad complex tachycardia. And when you have a broad complex tachycardia, then you have to differentiate from ventricular tachycardia. Or thirdly, they are more prone to get atrial fibrillation and they develop irregular broad complex tachycardia because that conducts over the accessory pathway. And the thing to remember is that accessory pathways like AV nodal reentrant tachycardia, they are almost 100% curable by radio frequency ablation. Now, in general, people don't die because of supraventricular tachycardia, but in patients who have got a WPW syndrome, if the conduction over the accessory pathway is very fast, that means if the refractory pathway is less than 260 milliseconds, then those patients can develop very fast ventricular response, and very fast ventricular response can produce ventricular fibrillation and they can die. So there are very few patients of WPW syndrome can die, have a sudden cardiac death because of the supraventricular tachycardia by making them go into ventricular fibrillation. So this is one thing you should remember. Now, how to differentiate AVNRT versus AVRT? In AVRT, usually you will be able to find P waves outside the QRS complex and which are usually inverted. They are inverted because the atria is being depolarized from below up. So you will find in particularly 2-3 AVF, you see very carefully, after the QRS complex, you will find a negative deflection. That is, if you can see P wave outside the QRS complex, just after the QRS complex, that's highly likely. You can say that this is the AVRT very clearly. Or if you cardiovert these patients or give them adenosine after the conversion, you can look whether there is a PWW syndrome on the ECG or not. So this is a AVNRT, it's a curable disease. That is the same patient in Sinus Rhythm. And the thing which you should remember, that this is called R prime. Now if you see V1, for example, this is the normal rhythm. This is during sinus rhythm, the V1, and this is during tachycardia. Just after the QRS complex, there is a small deflection. This is called R prime. This is P wave actually. In some of the patients, you can recognize it. Some of the patients, you can't recognize it. But if you can recognize, then you can also say that this is AVNRT. This is not AVRT. So treatment is RF ablation. And I must say that patient with supraventricular tachycardia, particularly regular tachycardia, in my opinion, there is no role of cardiolone. Please don't give them cardiolone because the drug is very toxic and they are curable with RF fibrillation. Okay. What is this tachycardia? AVRT. Right. I think the thing which bothers my mind here in this patient is that if you see LEAD-2, the P wave is upright. The P wave is upright in LEAD-2, even in AVF it is upright. So this is a very, very abnormal finding that you have upright in 2 and in AVF, even in LEAD-3, don't see negative P waves. I don't know what he says, but I will, if you have this kind of ECG, I would suspect first atrial tachycardia. I will not suspect AVRT. I don't know what he says. He says AVRT, but I think it's wrong. It is atrial tachycardia because if you see carefully here, this is upright P wave. This is also in AVF, this is upright P wave. P waves are outside the QRS complex. This is highly, highly unlikely to be AVRT. It is likely to be atrial tachycardia. Okay, so he says it's AVRT. Maybe something wrong with this. Okay. What is this? This is interesting, I think. This is interesting. Who is going to tell me what is this? So the options are sinus tachycardia, monomorph VT, VPC or SVT. SVT. So all of you are SVT. So Bathinda, everybody joined together. BPC, where is BPC by the way? Can you show me? You can come here forward, tell me where is BPC. Yeah, it is like you are right. It is like a right bundle branch block. But what is it? It is SVT or VT? It's VT. Very good. It's VT, I agree. But why? Pardon? If you see carefully, there are escape beads. It's a narrow complex bead. It's somewhere else also. Let me see where it is. Yeah, it is here also. It's a narrow complex. Look at this. This is V1. This bead is very different than the V4. This is very different than this. This is a normal bead. These are called escape beads. That means VT is going on, but one bead from the sinus node has percolated into the ventricle. If you see narrow complex beads between a broad complex beads, there is a VT. You could have either an escape bead or sometimes you can have a fusion bead. Fusion bead means that this bead will be narrower than the QRS tachycardia, but it will not be normal. So there is a mix, some VT component, some supraventricular. So if you see in a tachycardia, first of all, please don't just conclude that it's a narrow complex. It is actually, this is not a narrow complex. Narrow complex means QRS less than 100 milliseconds. If you measure here, you will have a QRS of 120, 130 milliseconds. It's not apparently broad, but it is relatively, it's a relatively, relatively narrow, relatively broad tachycardia. It's not narrow by definition, it's a broad complex tachycardia, but it's not too broad. That is why many people will confuse it as a supraventricular tachycardia. And when you have a VT, broad complex tachycardia, the way to differentiate whether it's a VT or it could be SVT with aberration are, if you have escape beats like this patient, if you have a fusion beat, or you can demonstrate AV dissociation somewhere in that ECG. If you demonstrate AV dissociation, it's a pakka sign that this is a ventricular tachycardia. If you have a history of ischemic heart disease, where you don't even see the ECG, it's likely to be VT. If you have QRS complexes in the limb leads, all negative or all positive, then it is very likely it's VT. Or if you have an axis which is northwest axis. Northwest axis is very, very difficult for any supraventricular tachycardia, so it's a ventricular tachycardia. Pardon? BPCs, in BPC you will have sinus rhythm, in between there will be broader complexes. That's a totally different story. Okay, so this is monomorph VT, and this is a special kind of VT. It's called fascicular VT. Fascicular means the re-entry here occurs between the fascicles. It goes from the anterior fascicle to the septum and back like this, because in the fascicles, the conduction is fast. In the myocardium, the conduction is slow. So if a VT is arising from the myocardial tissue, it will be more broad. If it's relatively narrow, it can only occur if it's coming from the His-Purkinje system. So here it is a fascicular VT, and the solution to this is ablation. It's very successful in these patients. Now, one thing more I want to tell you, that if a patient has basic ECG, broad complex, let's say usko left bundle branch block, but he develops a tachycardia which is relatively narrow, let's say basically left bundle branch block QRS complex is 140 milliseconds or 150 milliseconds, but he develops a tachycardia which is 125 milliseconds or 130 milliseconds, so what is the diagnosis? I have given enough hint. Basic ECG, broad complex, QRS complex 140 milliseconds. The same patient developed tachycardia, now the QRS is 130 milliseconds. Whether it is VT or it is SVT. No. If this patient develops supraventricular tachycardia, his QRS will be 140 milliseconds. Same as his normal, this is ventricular tachycardia. Now, if you have a, why it is narrow? Because most likely the origin is in the septum. So it is spreading very fast to both ventricles. In normal rhythm, there is a complete left bundle branch block, which takes long time to depolar the ventricle. But if it's a VT is coming from the septum, the QRS can be narrow. It's a very good point, if you should remember that. Okay. Now this is, what is this case? AVNRT. Okay. Why you say that? Can you see P waves? They are inverted. What is the relationship of P and QRS complex? PR is shorter than the RP. See, this is P, this is QRS. The PR is shorter than the RP. RP is long. So if you have a shorter PR than the RP, you can see there is a P wave clearly outside the QRS complex in this patient. So it is not likely to be AVNRT at all. And you are seeing the P wave before the QRS complex. That means that this is a activation coming from the atria. This is a this is atrial tachycardia, this is ectopic atrial tachycardia. Now, you can tell me now that from where in the atrium this is coming. Is it coming from the right atrium or left atrium? Anybody? Left atrium. Why you say left atrium, by the way? See, if... Listen, my dear. This is the left atrium, this side. AVL is here. If it is coming from the left atrium, the in the atrium, the depolarization will go from left to right, and it will be negative in AVL. But here, it is positive in AVL. So if it is positive in AVL, and it is positive even in 1, if you see lead 1, okay, it is positive here. If it was coming from left side, this way, then it will be negative in 1. So here the activation is occurring of the atria from the right to left. So that means it's a right atrial tachycardia. Ab right mein kahan se aa raha hai? Is it coming from the upper part of the atrium or the lower part of the atrium? Batao, it's not difficult, boss. It is just you have to apply the mind ki kahan se kidhar se bijli aa rahi hai. Okay, normally very right, lower part. It's not difficult. It's not a rocket. See, in 2-3 AVF, in normal sinus rhythm, activation occurs from above below. So it is positive. But here, it is negative. If you see clearly, it's very clearly negative in 2, in 3, and in AVF. Positive in AVL, positive in this. It is positive also in V1. Okay, so that also tells you that this is a lower part of the atrium, right atrium. So this is ectopic atrial tachycardia. You can tell the electrophysiologist that I am sending a patient who is atrial tachycardia, and I think most likely it originates in the lower part of the right atrium. Maza aa jaye na? Kyun bhai? Okay, so this is what it is. Again, the treatment is ablation in this patient. You don't have to do anything. Okay. What is this? This is simple. Yeah, it's AB block. You can see, you know, bradycardia and complete heart block. Is not difficult at all. Okay. What is this? I can stop whenever you want, but I have 100 ECGs with me. I can continue the whole night. What is this? Andy? First of all, tell me narrow complex or broad complex? It's not broad. It's a narrow complex tachycardia. It's a supraventricular, okay. Go further. Now when you say supraventricular, it could be atrial tachycardia, it could be atrial flutter, it could be atrial fibrillation, it could be AVNRT, it could be AVRT. So these are the conditions. Now tell me whether it is AVNRT, whether it is AVRT, whether it is atrial flutter, whether it is atrial fibrillation. Paanch to arrhythmia hai kuch nahi. This is a, there's another lead I want to tell you. What is the ventricular rate? Ventricular rate is 150. If you have a narrow complex tachycardia, heart rate 150, always suspect atrial flutter with 2:1 block. Why? Because usually atrial flutter, the rate is 300. Usually. And if you have a ventricular rate 150, that means 2:1 block. Now if you see carefully here, lead 2, you have inverted P waves. They are flutter waves. This way, like this. Atrial rate is 300 here. The ventricular rate is 150. This is atrial flutter. which usually, when you have an atrial flutter, it usually means a diseased heart. It's very common in rheumatic heart disease. It's common even in ischemic heart disease. But some of the patients, it can be also in practically a normal heart. But most of the times, there is some kind of cardiac disease. And again, atrial flutter, you can ablate very successfully, 90-95% chance that you can make the patient totally asymptomatic. This is a typical atrial flutter, counterclock loop, and again the treatment is ablation. What is this? Polymorphic VT. Anybody? Vital, where is Vital? No, first of all, tell me it's a VT or SVT. वो तो बाहर में जाएंगे वहाँ तो. Well, the thing is, I am not able to see very carefully, but to me it looks like a artifact. I think there may be an artifact. This patient, see, you sometimes. Artifact may be looking like this. If there's a some lead is not proper or patient is moving, you can have ECG like normal. And but if you see patient is वो ठीक ठाक बैठा है या लेटा हुआ है, this cannot be a polymorphic VT. But usually there are hints. For example, this maybe some of them may be narrow complex. Let's see what it says. But I can't see. I can't see. Usually what happens if you have a artifact like this is RR interval, you will be able to see some KRS complex in between which are not visible. So the DD in this patient is either a polymorph VT or an artifact. But as I told you that I am not able to see a clear cut KRS complex, so this is more likely to be a polymorph ventricular tachycardia, but patient can't be conscious in this. Usually they will become unconscious. Okay. What is this? Narrow complex or broad complex? Aapki bari aa gayi hai. No, first you. Narrow complex. Ye to bol do yaar, narrow hai. So it's a narrow complex. Regular or irregular? Regular tachycardia. So what is it? Very right. Supraventricular. But further. Go further. If you have narrow complex regular tachycardia, there are only practically three diagnoses. AVRT, AVRT or ATL tachycardia. Only three. So what is it? I have narrowed your differential diagnosis. AVRT. Why? Very right. Why? Very good. Excellent. I think you have become smarter now. Very, very good. If you see carefully, this after QRS complex, there are inverted P waves 2, 3, and AVF. The RP is shorter than the PR. Now, this is AVRT. You can say definitely this ECG is very clear that this is AVRT. No doubt about it. Very good. Okay, so this is AVRT, short RP tachycardia, and RP is more than 70 milliseconds. Okay, this was I think the ECG of the same patient. What is it? Say it again. No. See, it is a supraventricular tachycardia, which is based on the accessory pathway. In accessory pathway, now what is happening? that it is the impulse is coming over the AV node to his Purkinje system to the ventricle, then going back over the pathway. When it has to go over the pathway, then naturally atria will be stimulated from low to up, from base to up. So that is why the PA wave will be inverted. It will be difficult to say in this patient whether it is right side pathway or a left side pathway. Okay. What is this? This is not difficult. LVBV, okay, it's possible. Broad complex, it looks like LVBV, but anything more? Can you go further? Anterior wall MI. Okay, let me give you a hint. If you see lead 2 and lead V1, how much is PR interval? How much is PR interval? Lead 2 here is very short, isn't it? So if you have a short PR interval, you have a little broad complex rhythm. It's a sinus rhythm. It's a WW syndrome. It's not difficult. In fact, I thought you will tell me WW. I wanted to ask, hai kahan pathway? The thing which I want to ask is that where is the location of the pathway? Ye pathway hai, ye to main nahi expect karta ki aapko na pata ho. So this is a clearly a WW syndrome. Now tell me, where is the pathway? See, for defining the pathway, again you have to, it's just, again simple question is of vector. You need to study the vector, that the QRS complex axis, particularly the initial part of the QRS complex, the delta wave. Now this is a delta wave here, a delta wave here. If you see AVL here, see in 2, 3, AVF, it's positive complex. It's positive. That means it is not inferior, it is superior line, and it is AVL, it is positive. So this pathway is likely to be antroceptal pathway. Antroceptal pathway or midseptal pathway. Now this pathway is difficult to relate. Why? Because it's very close to the normal AV node. It's positive in 2, 3 AVF. It's positive in AVL. It's antroceptal pathway. Little difficult to relate. And the risk of heart block in this patient is higher as compared to other pathways. So this is pre-excitation. Okay. What is this ECG? What is this? Is it broad complex or narrow? Broad, very right. Is it regular or irregular? Irregular, very right. Is the irregularity has some pattern, or it's irregularly irregular? It is irregularly irregular. So again, it is not a rocket sounds. If it is an irregularly irregular rhythm, it is likely to be atrial fibrillation. VT, for example, is not so irregular, you know. And this is ECG which can be confused with polymorphic ventricular tachycardia, but this is not a polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. This is a, because if you see here, for example, there is a lot of irregularity. Here RR interval is this much and next is very, very different. So this is a broad complex tachycardia with atrial fibrillation. Now this is very likely that there is a WW syndrome, because the during atrial fibrillation the main conduction in this patient is occurring over the pathway. So even the fusion is different, some are little broad, some are less. So this is one ECG which you should always remember in mind. Now the thing which you should remember is that if this patient comes to, let's say it's a 20 years boy, he comes with patient to you, how will you treat him? With what? I will lose it. What else? Okay. The doctor in the emergency diagnosed this patient as supraventricular tachycardia with aberration, and he gave IV verapamil to this patient. And this patient had a cardiac arrest, developed ventricular fibrillation. Why? Right, but why the conduction should increase after IV verapamil? Okay, block to aapne kar diya, lekin rate kyun bada? Indel, your thinking is correct by the way. Verapamil will block the normal AV node, so more conduction will occur over the accessory pathway, lekin rate kyun bada? Because verapamil will produce lowering of blood pressure and increase catecholamine. When the BP goes down, catecholamine are released. So this catecholamine will make the conduction fast over the pathway. So these patients, you should not give IV beta blocker, IV verapamil, IV adenosine. Here, if you want to give drug, the safest drug is cardrone, because cardrone will block both. It will block the AV node, it will block the pathway also. Another drug which can be given is IV procainamide, but procainamide usually is not available in India, so safe is cardrone or cardioversion. Okay. What is this? Pardon? Very right. This is simple, narrow complex, irregular heart rate. The commonest arrhythmia in the world today is atrial fibrillation. If you see the increasing age of people, hypertension, diabetes, by the time you reach 80 years old, the incidence of atrial fibrillation is almost 10% of the people in the world. So if you have 10% atrial fibrillation in the world, so it's a quantum, it's a massive health problem in the world. And one of the atrial fibrillation is not a benign arrhythmia, by the way, because it's very clear that it increases mortality and there's a lot of morbidity attached. Morbidity in the sense that people are highly symptomatic, many of them, number one. Number two, there is a real risk of CVA. You know, one of the most important implication of atrial fibrillation is a stroke. And any patient who has got atrial fibrillation should be on anticoagulation, not aspirin, not clopidogrel, not a combination of aspirin and clopidogrel. They should be anticoagulated, either vitamin K antagonist like acetrom or warfarin, or you can give the NOACs, the newer drugs like dabigatran or apixaban. It will be actually a almost criminal neglect if you don't put them on anticoagulation. Of course, you need to explain to them the INR and the risk of bleeding, but you need to give something to these patients. Okay. There is nothing much in this. This is the ECG of that patient I was trying to teach. I think there is a uski theek laga nahi hua tha. This is the ECG where should see some ST elevation in V1, lead V2 and V3. This is a very subtle change because most of us will pass this as a normal ECG. But this is a typical ECG of Brugada syndrome. This is like a ventricular polymorph VT. The same patient with the Brugada syndrome. So what is this? Anybody? Well, you know, thing is that this is a broad complex tachycardia, very broad I would say, very fast. This is a ventricular tachycardia by any criteria. This is a monomorph VT. The complex remains same. If you see any lead, they don't change from time to time. Even in the lead lower one, this is VT again, this patient. This is a patient who had ARVC, arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. Why, you know, you can, even from the ECG, you can diagnose that this VT is coming from the right ventricle. Why? Because you have a left bundle branch morphology. Okay? It's a left, if the VT is coming from the right ventricle, it will have a left bundle morphology. If the VT is coming from the right ventricle, it will have a right bundle, RBV morphology. I showed that fascicular VT, it had right bundle morphology. That fascicular VT was coming from the left ventricle. Similarly, you can go further that, okay, this is coming from the right ventricle, lekin wo apex se aa raha hai ya outflow se aa raha hai. We can go further. 2-3 AVF is negative. 2-3 AVF is negative. That means the activation is coming from below up. That means it's coming from the apical portion. And in AV, right ventricular arrhythmogenic ventricular tachycardiomyopathy, the usual disease at the apex of the mid cavity level. So this is a ACG of arrhythmogenic right ventricular ARVC. Okay, 50 years old man with the history of syncopal attack. What is this? Anybody? If I say ECG, the echo is normal. Pardon? Coronary? Normal ECG. Okay, anybody else? Syncope ho rahi hai us bande ko? Behosh ho raha hai do din baar. Well, I think, pardon? Where? Right. No, I think there is a, this is a ECG of, kahan gaya bhi? Yeah. There is a ST elevation in V1, V2. This is again Brugada syndrome. Okay. Nothing much we can see. This is a, can you tell me the changes in this ECG, anybody? Yes, V1, V2, and then there is some depolarization after the QRS complex. This is called epsilon wave. There is a delayed conduction, that means again scarring. So this ECG after the QRS complex, you see after depolarization, this is epsilon wave, V1, V2, V3 T wave inversion. This is the ECG of a arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. So what is this? Okay, I'll give a hint to you. This is a 60 years male who comes to the emergency with chest pain. This is the ECG. Which one? Inferior wall. Okay. Anybody else? See, aren't you a little surprised that there is a V2, 3, AVR? There are a lot of changes in this ECG. They are frightening ECG, you know, ST depressions. Okay, what is happening in AVR? What is happening in AVR? Pardon? Very good, excellent. If you have ST elevation in AVR, this is ST elevation in AVR, this is a left main disease. This patient needs immediate angiography and bypass surgery. Maybe put him on intra-aortic balloon pump, take him to the... If you delay the angiography, it's almost, you can lose this guy. Left main disease, you are very right, excellent. What is this? If this patient, you have ST elevation in, yeah, interoceptal, yeah, that's right. This may not be fresh, this may be old infarction, but this is interoceptal myocardial infarction. This is simple. Very right. Acute inferior wall myocardial infarction. There are reciprocal changes in the anterior leads, and usually it means a right coronary artery. This is again ST elevation in 2, 3 AVR, and anterior wall almost like a similar the previous acute inferior wall infarction. What is this? What is this ECG? Well, the ECG shows here interoceptal myocardial infarction, and it also shows atrial fibrillation with fast ventricular response. This is a both the things you have. There is no QS pattern in 1, V2, V3. Even this ST, you are up in V4, V5, and pretty fast rate interoceptor myocardial infarction, anterior wall myocardial infarction with the AF and fast ventricular response. Okay. What is this? Very right, this is WW syndrome. Now I want to ask the gentleman, where is this pathway? It's a delta wave, very good, very nice delta wave actually. You see very short PR interval, delta wave, many leads, delta wave, delta wave. It's a positive delta in 2 AVF, AV3, positive in AVL. This is again a interoceptal pathway situated on the right side. Pre-excitation, WW syndrome, and okay, this is not difficult. You should jump on this. What is this? Thak to nahi gaye tum log? Not tired, na? What is this, boss? This is right bundle advance block and atrial flutter. You see flutter waves very clearly, so-called sawtooth appearance, right bundle advance block, atrial flutter. Atrial flutter, counterclock loop. Now, atrial flutter is described as a typical and atypical flutter. Typical is that means the re-entry is occurring from the septum to the top to the lateral wall like this over the isthmus. So this could be either clockwise or anticlockwise. So in counterclockwise, when it is counterclock, it is going up the septum from below up. So P waves are, the flutter waves are inverted. But if they are other way around, then the P waves are positive in 2-3 AVFs. But doesn't matter whether it is a counterclock or clockwise, you always ablate the isthmus. You complete the ablation on the right side, starting from the CS to the IVC. That area you ablate, so break the circuit, and these patients do very well. But sometimes, if the re-entry is not occurring over the isthmus, for example, if a patient has some surgery in the past, ASG or something else, some of these flutters occur around the scar area. So those are described as atypical flutters, and ablation of those flutters is difficult. You need three-dimensional imaging by CARTO or some other technology to ablate those atrial flutter. This is again, I think, very common scene, acute myocardial infarction. Here if you see AVR is down, it is not up. Gross ST elevation, hyperacute myocardial infarction, and okay. Should we stop or we want to continue? Now if you have an inferior wall infarction, you should always take right chest leads to diagnose right ventricular myocardial infarction. In some of the patients with lateral infarction, you may have to take a lead chest 7, chest 8 and chest 9, go posteriorly to record some of those ECGs. So what is this ECG? Yes, looks like old intraceptal myocardial infarction and looks like atrial fibrillation. It is a irregular narrow complex tachycardia, AF with fast ventricular response. I think this should be enough. If you have any questions, pardon? Posterior wall MI, you go behind. In posterior wall, you will have changes more in the AVL and V6, V7, V8. The posterior, posterior wall, you will have in V1, lead V1, very tall T waves in V1 only. Posterior wall is diagnosed from that V1. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. I request Dr. Rajkumar from Mansa to kindly facilitate a speaker.
Mitul sir, anything else you want me to do? If you want to ask any question in cardiology or management issues, you are welcome to ask. Thank you.